Hi, in this video, I'm going to demo Google new open source package, Model Search. Now, Model Search is a domain agnostic open source AutoML platform for finding optimal neural network architecture. You can find more details about this package. It was only released yesterday. You can find it in the Google AI blog, introducing Model Search and open source platform. Typically, when we talk about a neural network, there are multiple factors that come into play. They have listed some of the factors. There are a lot more as well, like what does the appropriate neural network architecture looks like, or how deep it should be, what type of layer should be used, what kind of normalization do we use. There are multiple hyperparameters and parameters play a role in a neural network architecture. So Model Search is a package that helps you optimize this architecture in a pretty much automated way. Now, there are already some of the existing architecture search, like neural architecture search, or which uses deep reinforcement learning or evolutionary algorithms. The major drawback is it is very compute intensive and it creates thousands of models to find the right architecture. What basically in the Model Search does is it's pretty domain agnostic. When I say domain agnostic, like typically the earlier neural network architecture search, you need to feed the right domain, whether it's image classification, then it will develop a convolution neural network. If it's a natural language processing, then it may develop an LSTM or a transformer architecture or any other architecture. Similarly, for a traditional tabular data, it needs to find architecture more like a deep neural network, feed-forward neural network architecture. Right? Here in this case, it is completely domain agnostic. And we are going to see a demo on how it can be done. Now, there are a lot of details on this paper. Okay, you can go and look at how it works. You can also go to the GitHub repo. And this GitHub repo has all the information and code to execute Model Search. But again, this package is completely new. Installing it and making it running is not straightforward. I'm going to show you how you can get your first architecture search model up and running, right? But you can go to this particular GitHub page and you will find a lot of information. Now let's come back to the code. So the very first thing I'm doing, there's no pip install. You need to clone this particular repo. Whatever repo I have shown over here, what I'm doing is I'm doing a git clone of that particular repo and I'm downloading the entire repository to my Google Colab environment. It can be your local environment as well. And I am kind of going into the Model Search directory. It will create a directory called Model Search. I'm going into the directory. My present working directory is this. I have ran few of the steps to save time. Right, and that's what I'm just working time, but I will run like steps like where we are going to the modeling phase and everything. Then I am listing the directory, and you can see like these are all the content of the directory. You have one more Model Search directory which has all the open source packages. You have the requirement.txt which has all the dependencies. So what I'm doing is I'm taking the requirement.txt and installing all the dependencies. I'm just telling a pip install -r requirement.txt. It will install all the dependencies that is required to make this Model Search package runnable, right? So I have installed everything. Now let's go and search the directory. These installation steps are not mentioned in the GitHub repo. So that's why I'm taking, because I had difficulty installing this particular package. It took me some time. So this will help you like install it pretty fastly, because for me, I had to do research and then correct it. So this is the directory listing. And there's one more package called Proto, which has all the proto buff files. So what we need to do is we need to use proto compiler to compile all these proto buff files. And that's what I'm doing in my next step. Within this proto directory, I have multiple proto files. I am calling the proto-c, which is nothing but the protocol buffer compiler. And then I'm giving all these packages. Once you run this, you will get all the compiled code of it. And then I'm going to download the data set. I'm using the credit default data set that is available in the UCI machine learning repository for this purpose. So if you take a typical neural network architecture, you will have a lot of categorical data and numerical data. You may have like other kinds of data as well. Now the neural architecture search does not do any kind of feature handling. So that is left to the programmer. So once you have the feature handling and final features ready, then you can feed it to your neural network. So basically, neural network expects some of the numerical value to be scaled, use a min-max scalar zero, and that is all left to us. The model does not handle everything. So we will do some of the feature engineering, and then we will feed it to the model architecture search. So this is the data set I have. I'm going to download this data set. And this is the credit default data set. Let me quickly list it to see if the data set is downloaded. Yes, it is downloaded. I'm importing some set of packages. I'm using pandas to basically load the Excel file. And then I have like visualization and data analysis. I'm using seaborn and matplotlib. I'm just going to do quick visualization because that is not the core purpose of this particular demo. But when you take a real data set, you want to explore more and get more insights on what feature to use and what not to use. And then I'm using, I'm importing these packages, min-max scalar, if there are a lot of numerical data where the range is completely which has different ranges and everything. I want to use min-max scalar to bring it in the same scale so that my model can converge faster. And these are the different packages I'm importing for the model search. So let me run this, and then I'm importing the credit default data set, and let me quickly see the data, how it looks like. So this is how the data looks like. Basically, I have the balance that is allocated to the customer. I have a sex, education, marriage, whether from the last payment, how much he was delayed. If it's -1, the payment was on time. If it is 1, then he was 1 month delayed. If it is 2, it's 2 month delayed. And what was the bill amount? Well, there are a lot of other features that are there in this particular set. That's the bill amount, what was the last payment he made, and finally a column called default payment next month, which tells whether the customer is defaulted or not. 1 is for default, 0 is for not default, right? The call target column name is pretty big, so what I'm just doing is I'm taking it and renaming the column default payment next month to default, and I'm assigning back to the data frame. That's what I'm doing. Now I have 3 categorical data in this case. Basically, if you see over here, I have 3: sex, education, and marriage. I'm going to quickly visualize and see whether this particular variable really contributes to the output. It's just for feature selection purpose. I can drop this feature if I find like sex does not determine whether a customer is going to default or not. Education does not determine whether a customer is going to default or not. So for that, I'm just using seaborn. So what I'm doing is I am first taking like the sex variable along with the default. I'm just creating a default U, and the input variable is sex. I'm doing a count plot, and then what I'm doing is I'm just iterating through this particular plot and giving percentages for each and every bar that you see. So once you see the output, you will get to know. So this you can skip this step. If you just want to do visual analysis, you can completely skip the bottom part. But this will just add on the top what percentage of subscribers or what percentage of customers are in the default and non-default by in this case gender, right? So in this case, 1 is male and 2 is female. If you see, many customers are female, and female, like out of 48% female, 13% have defaulted, and here out of like 30% male, 10% have defaulted. So this is one variable. Now this variable, if you see, like 3 times, almost like the default to non-default is 1/3, right? Here, if you see, it's little less than 1/3. So there seems to be some correlation with the sex. So maybe I want to keep that variable. Similarly, I'm doing for education, and I am also doing for marriage. So this is education, this is like married, this is single. You can go to the UCI repository, this data set, all the data dictionary is available where you can check what this 4, 5, 6, everything mean. But here, if you see, there seems to be some correlation. I'm just going to blindly keep this value for now. Just wanted to show you also need to go do all the visualization of all the variables to understand whether that particular variable contributes or not, right? So finally, what I'm going to basically do in this case is I'm going to take all the so this was education. I just said it's married or single. This one was marriage, actually, which 1 is single and 2 is married. Okay. Now in the categorical data, what I'm doing is I'm going to create two variables. I'm going to create categorical data and numeric data. I'm not going to select all the data for this particular model, as my intention is to show how neural network architecture search works, which is the newly open sourced model search package by Google. So I've created categorical data and I have created like these three variables. The first three is sex, education and marriage. And I've created some kind of numerical data, which is nothing but all the pay values and everything. So I have ignored some of the bill amount values and all, but you can add it and you can do a min-max scaling on top of it. But here, like, because it's all -2, 0, and 1, I'm just going to ignore the scaling for now. Okay, so first I'm doing a data preparation. That's what I'm doing. I'm doing a data preparation so that I can create a file to feed to the neural architecture search model. And for that, I have created this categorical and numerical data. For the categorical data, my neural network, I need to basically one not encode the variable, right? If it's a tree-based model and all, I can just do numerical encoding. But because like your neural network model, it's similar to like it assigns weights to each and every category, we don't want it to consider that, okay, the one education level is greater than other. So that's why we are one not encoding it. And for that, I'm using pandas get dummies method. I am passing all the categorical variables here, data of categorical, and telling the column names, and basically I will get a one not encoded value of this particular variable. Just a minute, like, okay, I didn't run this particular step. And then let me run this. So I'll get a one not encoded a list of all this particular variable, right? And similarly, I'm taking all the numerical variable and I am taking this, the data that we created on the top, that is a data final. I'm taking all the numeric variable that we have and I'm taking the default value, which is my target value, and creating a data frame, final data frame. So this is how my final data frame looks like. Default is the target value, then all the categorical value, and then the numerical value will be there. That in total 20 columns over here, and there are 30,000 rows. What I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly visualize how my target looks like. My target is like not defaulted is 20,000 and defaulted is 6,000. So it's pretty highly imbalanced data. Now in neural network, we can add class imbalance parameter, or we can downsample or upsample. But for now, I'm just going to run it as it is. Right now, once this data set is there, I'm going to save this data set as CSV files. Now, this particular trainer does not take pandas data frame directly, but you can create a custom class if you have a non-CSV data, and then you can feed it over there. But for now, I'm going to consider it as CSV data, and I'm taking the data frame, I'm creating a 2CSV file, and then storing it. So it will finally create a file called default.csv. Now, till now, what I have done is I have not gone into the model search tool at all. I just prepared the data for me. Since it's a neural network data, if I have all numerical, all within like some ranges of 0 to 1 or 0 or close by, right, I can just directly use those variables. But in this case, what I am basically doing it, I have some categorical values. I am just doing a one-not encoding of it. And then I have created data frame and saved the file. Now we will come to the model search. Now, the next thing, first thing what we are doing is we are going to create an trainer instance. So that's where basically there is a single trainer object, and I'm creating a trainer instance over here. And in the trainer instance, I am providing my data as CSV data. Okay, and in the CSV data, there are some parameters. I am telling my label is in the zeroth index. The first column is default. The column index starts with zero. I'm telling it's zeroth index. Currently, model search only supports classification problem, not regression problem. So if you have regression problem, then this might not help. Only for classification problem, this is valid. I'm telling my logic's dimension is 2. I have only 2 classes. One is default and other is not default. And finally, I'm telling my record defaults. So I have 20 columns. I'm just telling, like, in case there's any missing value, just impute zeros for all. Right. And then I'm telling my file name, which is default.csv I stored in the top. So that's what I created, and I'm creating my spec. So this spec is how you want to run your deep learning model. Now you can use a default spec, which will search a larger space. But if you already have some domain knowledge and you know this is the space, this is the search space you want to go and search, you can go and control this file and limit the search space. That's what this DNN config is about. Right. So now I'm creating a trainer object. I'm going to create a directory called run example where I want to store my the store my entire run results. So basically I'll be doing multiple run, multiple models and everything. So I just wanted directly to store it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click this and I'm going to create the directory. I'm not going to remove the directory in case if you want to rerun it. So you want to clean up the directory, you can use this command, but I'm not going to do it. Now, this when you run this, you may face one error. You may get like unrecognized flag error, unknown command line F. So this error you might get, you might not get. In case if you get, I would say go and run this particular line. What I'm doing is I'm catching this particular error and then I'm just going to pass this whatever error it is, so that my so that basically the model search algorithms that the trainer object starts, otherwise the trainer object will fail. So just run this if you get this error. Otherwise, you can ignore this line itself. Now, once I have done that, I am going to take my trainer object and I am going to call the function try models. So try models will try different models. Now, what I'm telling is how many models I want to try. I want to try 5 models and I want to train for 5 steps each. And my eval step will be 1. How frequently I want to evaluate. Say my train step is 100. I can give my eval step is 10. So every 10 steps, evaluate the model. That's what I'm telling over here. I'm giving a root directory where to save the experiments. It will save under run underscore sample that I created on the top. I'm giving my batch size as 512. You can give any batch size. And I'm just giving an experiment name and experiment owner. These are the two parameters I'm giving. If it's better to run for higher models, it is asynchronous. It can run in multiple threads. If you on a real world, you may want to run it for some 100 or 200 model to get the best architecture, right? But in this case, for this demo, I'm just limiting to 5 models. And once I have set the trainer object, I will go ahead and run this. What it is going to do is it's going to start the trainer object and start creating multiple models and basically going to create the model, train the model, and also evaluate frequently. Now, it may take some time, but basically, till now, what we have done is we first prepare the data. Right, preparing the data is most tedious activity. You may have to do data cleaning, you may have to do feature engineering, you may have to do data pre-processing, multiple things you might have to do. In this case, I removed some of the amount columns and all, but if you want to use the amount columns, go ahead and use it and use like a min-max scaler so that you can scale the data so that the model converts faster. But preparation was most of the part. If you see the actual model search part, you have this, I created a trainer object. Now this trainer object, if you have a non-CSV file, you can create a custom trainer object also. And if you go to this particular window, you can see below how the trainer object is created. You can basically see how you can create a custom trainer object. Basically, it will tell for non-CSV data. You can go and follow those steps. Now, after that, I just gave my trainer how many models I want to try and how many train steps I want to try. It's going to start running it. It's going to intermittently show you all the run metrics and everything. So what I will do is I'll pause the video for some time and allow it to learn. And once it completes, I will kind of come back and show you the results. See, now the model has completed training, and basically you can go and check for we had given 5 trials and then basically 5 training steps per trial. So 5 training steps is very less to get a good model for 30,000 rows that we have. Maybe we want to train it for 20 or 30 when you are trying it out. But let's see like how it performed with 5 steps. And you can basically see each and every trial ID. This is the 5th trial ID. If you go on the top, you may find the 4th trial ID, and you can see like in the 4th trial ID, the accuracy is 0.70 over here. And then this is the step number 5 within trial 4. And then the AUC ROC is 0.60. The AUC PR is not good. And the reason can be the class is imbalanced and we have to maybe go and customize the hyperparameters where we had class imbalance, or we prepare the data in such a way that the class is balanced, right? Now, what it also does, you can see like go and check all the trial IDs before and get how the model performed. This is the previous one where it's 0.75. And then basically this is the 3rd trial. You can see basically this is the 3rd trial. And this is the fifth step within the third trial, and you can go and check it out. It says like 0.75 is accuracy again. And in this case, the AUCPR is even worse, even the ROC. That means this model is not good. The fourth model was good. And what it does in the final step, it also creates a ensemble model. So basically, for example, this is a trial 4. Let's see like basically trial 5, which is at the bottom. And in the trial file, it will also like basically try to create an ensemble search model. And that's what it does. So it has automatically found the architecture which fits the data better. Only thing is we need to train for more epoch and maybe allow it to find even more models to see what fits the data better. Now, what you can do is like once the model is trained, you can also go and this is the directory that we created on the top. And within that it will create a tuner. And then within that, it will basically create the trial ID that we have. We have 5 trials. You will have trial 2, trial 3, trial 4 and all. I can go into trial 2 and see all the files. Basically, you can see all the model checkpoint files. As if you want to deploy the model, you can just take this model checkpoint files and then you can deploy it. You also have the graph over here, which is nothing but graph.pb text file, which will tell you the entire model architecture. So the deployment artifacts are available for each and every step. If you go to the number 3, you will find the third trial that created and all the model files here for you to go and deploy it. You can also go to the pb text file over here and you can view the architecture if you want to go and see how the architecture was and everything. Currently, these steps are pretty manual. As I said, there's a pretty new open source package. These steps are pretty manual that you need to go and look at. Maybe in the future they announce it, but still, like, it gives a good idea. If I have a new data set, I can quickly run the model search. I can go and analyze how the architecture looks like. I can see which performs better. I can take that, and on top of that, maybe I can go and do specific hyperparameter test or something like that, or I can go and edit the specification itself rather than running at the entire search space. I can limit it, and that's what kind of I mentioned, like when you create your trainer object, maybe basically on the top, just a minute, let me go on the top. When you create a trainer object, you can specify over here, like in this config file, you can go and limit your how your DNN network should be, right? That you can go and limit it over here. So that's about it. You can find more detail, as I said, on the Google AI blog. This is a pretty new blog that came in yesterday over here, and also the GitHub repo. So that's about it. Thank you very much.